You could say that our story starts with John Travolta's film, Saturday Night Fever, about the disco craze. But that isn't really true. You have to go all the way back to Elvis Presley, to the Beatles, to rock and roll, and then finally comes disco. A very large, very lucrative new business of dance music. Maybe the biggest wave yet, because it certainly seems that more and more Americans are getting more and more into the disco scene.
This is the scene outside a New York disco called Studio 54. This is the place that's in with the disco crowd, except that these people are still out. Of course, Liza Minnelli and her kind of celebrities sweep right through the protective ranks of doorkeepers. One of the owners, Steve Rubell, works the door. He is choosy about who gets in, and that adds to the mystique and the desperation to be accepted. There is no live performance inside, no musicians, it's all records. Once inside, you begin to understand the attraction. For a disco to be a disco, you need a very heavy bass beat. The music has to have a hook. A hook is an easily recognizable theme or musical phrase, a vocal line. Something as simple as, "I love you." And the amazing thing, the really different thing about the disco record business is that a record producer can hit big money without the record ever being played on radio. Now that's a new one for the record business, which has always relied heavily on radio for hits. Once a record is accepted by the clubs and by the dancers, it can easily make profits in the hundreds of thousands in the record stores before any significant radio play, solely on the basis of word of mouth from disco customers and a lot of advertising.
If, as the record plays, everybody leaves the dance floor, that's probably the end. On the other hand, if the dancers like it, it can be the beginning of really big money. There are more than 6,000 discos spread all across the country. Between what the discos take in and what they generate with the records, we are talking about an estimated $4 billion, that's with a B, $4 billion a year.
If you want to know about instant success, 28-year-old A.J. Cervantes, president of Butterfly Records, is a prime example. Chances are you haven't heard about Butterfly Records. Well, it was put together last summer, mostly with borrowed money. Since then, they put out 5 albums, 4 of them disco. Gross sales over the last 6 months are nearly $3.5 million.
Right now the market's as strong. We're talking about New York. We're talking about Philadelphia. Pittsburgh came in yesterday for a strong reorder on the single.
Butterfly's latest releases are Too Hot for Love and Tuxedo Junction, a disco remake of old Glenn Miller songs.
But because of the kinds of promotion that we do, we have 2 people on the phone continuously talking to all the key disco DJs in the country. We have 2 people on the phone talking to all the retail outlets in the country. We begin to get this feedback.
Did you get a chance to listen to that Tuxedo Junction Chattanooga Choo-Choo single?
What time is your sales meeting?
Really?
It's an album for almost everybody.
The telephones never stop. The staff keeps pushing, keeps tabulating, keeps planning.
The adult contemporary response has been major. So we'd like to do an adult contemporary edit and remix with a little less disco feel, a little less hard
Which
kick
tune
drum.
Do you want to do?
Chattanooga Choo Choo. And I think since we're doing Chattanooga, we should also do Moonlight Serenade.
How is a disco record made? The illusion that most of us have is that a large group of talented musicians and singers gathers in a studio to record a song. It doesn't quite work that way. In this session, the bass drum and other percussion have already been recorded. So have the strings, believe it or not, of the New York Philharmonic. That was all done on other occasions. Now, a young musician introduces a guitar, listening on earphones to what's been recorded. Add the piano. This is Peter Brown's record, as composer, musician, and singer. This is for the TK Record Company, one of the biggest disco outfits. $7.5 million in gross disco sales a year. And here's how Peter directed the number called Dance With Me.
You got it.
he adds a track for the Moog synthesizer. Now watch Betty Wright do her first part. And the second voice. And the third. Three for one. Now the lead singer, Peter, with Pat Hurley.
Get on your feet. Come on and dance with me. Say the word and I'll summon the band. Say the word and I'll summon the band.
And the background vocals.
My hand.
The technique is called multi-track overdubbing. It is not new. What's new is that most all pop records now are made this way. But that's only the first step. John Ferrara is a producer, composer, and arranger for another label called Discomania. The selection is Mi Amore. His job at this stage is mixing 24 tracks of individual vocals and instruments into a finished product that will defy you to keep your feet from moving to the dance floor. He's invited disc jockeys from prominent New York clubs to listen and advise. Mixing is a meticulously slow and laborious process, taking many hours, almost like composing on the spot.
Start off with just an eardrum, Bob. Just bass drum. Just bass drum. Nothing else. Leave this out. Just get this nice and hot, and this is going to be our focal point. Everything's going to be based around the bass drum. Okay? So let's get as hot and as pulsating as we can. I don't want to have... Now listen right from the head. You let me know, man. If it's not cooking, if it's not making, we're not going to do it. If you don't have that feeling, then it doesn't matter.
It's got to have that drive.
Okay. Yeah, we're getting there. Hey, we'll work it out. We'll work it out. Relax.
They tried it out for the first time at a disco called New York, New York. It seemed to work.
Disco records come out on more than 400 different labels. Big producers, tiny ones. The competition is fierce. A whole label can completely disappear after one unsuccessful release. The promoters come by and visit the disc jockeys in their booths before the action starts at night, pushing their latest releases. If a DJ likes a number, he may give it a whirl. But remember, the DJ's own reputation is on the line, as well as the success of the record itself. As a result, only...